Hi and welcome. Thank you for joining us for this coveted 1 p.m. time spot here on Educators Day. I know we had a lot of really stiff competition, so thank you for joining us. And if you're watching the recording, we're also happy that you're here with us. So we're going to go ahead and get started to tell you a little bit more about Smithsonian Libraries and Archives, and how you can use our resources in your work. And before we get started, I do want to follow up on Dr. Chisholm's lovely land acknowledgement this morning, and also gratefully acknowledge the Piscataway people on whose ancestral lands I live. And we also have a couple of housekeeping reminders for you. This session will be closed captioned, so you should be able to enable that at the bottom of your screen. We're also hoping to take advantage of the chat and poll features along your screen, so please join us in the chat. And as we also want to remind you to take that nice little survey for our session there as well. And finally, we'll be sharing a lot of links today, which will all be encapsulated in our session handout. It doesn't look like the session handout has been uploaded into Cvent yet, but it will be available after the session. You're welcome to furiously scribble if you want to, or click along to follow us, but all of the links will be available after the session. So don't feel like you're missing anything if you don't. Sara, I think you're muted.
Got it now. Hi, guys. I am Sara Cardello. I'm the head of education for the Smithsonian Libraries and Archives, and super happy to have everyone here today. I'd also like to acknowledge the land of the Anacostians that I'm coming to you from, and also to acknowledge that we're all coming together here on Turtle Island, which is the ancestral name for North America. So I think that's really special. And I wanted to also just add housekeeping wise that there is about a 30 second delay if you are in the live. So there may be just a little bit of off timing with some of the question and answers, but we are getting to you. So don't feel forgotten. I'm Sara and this is Erin.
I'm Erin. I'm the outreach librarian for Smithsonian Libraries and Archives. I spend a lot of my time doing presentations where I help connect outside users with our resources. I also manage our social media program and our internship programs. And I think we'll go ahead and get moving.
Our goals for the session. We really just want to take a minute and introduce to everybody the Smithsonian Libraries and Archives, who we are, what we have in our collections, how you can explore our collections on your own time, find things that work for you in your classroom, your museum, wherever you might be coming to us from. And exploring then on top of that, things that have been specifically designed for an educator and student audience. So we'd like to be able to show different collections and things that we've got on hand for you, and then also share a new digital collection concept that we're building. And we would love to get feedback from you all about that and begin to shape it in a way that would be really useful for you, our users.
And now I was muted. So for a little bit of context, I'm sure you're familiar with what a library does. You have libraries in your own school systems, but not everybody knows that the Smithsonian has a library, let alone 21 of them. And so to give you a little bit of an idea of what we do here at the Smithsonian, we're a centralized library system and an institutional archive responsible for a dynamic and multifaceted role within the Smithsonian. So we help staff here at the institution and researchers find the information that they need to help them with their work, but we also maintain our own collections and programs. So in the same way that the National Museum of Natural History has the Hope Diamond, or the National Museum of American History has Dorothy's Ruby Slippers, our books and archival material are our collections, and we strive to share them with the world. And establishing both a library and an archives was explicitly mentioned in the earliest documents of the institution. So since 1846, the institution's librarians and archivists have preserved our books, research, and stories. And just recently, in December of 2020, the Smithsonian Libraries and the Smithsonian Institution Archives joined to become one unit. So we're still in the process of integrating, and you'll notice some inconsistencies about our name and logo as we work through some of our web pages and things. But that's a long process that we're still continuing. And we will mention some Smithsonian Institution Archives materials in our presentations, but it's going to largely focus on the library resources we have available to you. Our library collections support the scholarly work of the institution, and there is essentially a library for every museum and research center at the Smithsonian. And each of those library locations collects material that supports the work done in that museum. And even during normal non-pandemic times, our branches are actually open to the public by appointment. When we're in more precedented times, anybody can visit our 21 branches and do research in them. And if you're affiliated with another library system, a public library, college library, university library system, you can actually often borrow our books through your library system through interlibrary loan. So I do want to mention that now. There are, again, some limitations due to the ongoing pandemic, but aside from our rare books and some of our special collections, there are actually a lot of things that you can borrow through your own library. So in our 21 branches, we still have some good old-fashioned books. We have almost 3 million books in our collection, and 100,000 of those are considered rare. We actually have two rare book libraries. But we also manage and provide access to more than 300,000 journals and databases for our researchers, both online and in print. And in addition, we have some really interesting non-book collections that are unique and can be really useful to researchers. These include our trade literature collection, which is kind of like vintage junk mail. These are catalogs and mailers from the 1800s to the day that really tell the story of how things were advertised, how they worked, and a lot of advertising history, et cetera. We also have an extensive collection of art and artist files. This is another ephemeral collection of newspaper clippings, gallery invitations, and exhibition catalogs related to art and artists from around the world. The Smithsonian Institution Archives holds more than 44,000 cubic feet of physical archival collections and more than 22 terabytes of born digital collections, documenting the history of the Smithsonian and its people, buildings, programs, and research. Our collections range from a draft of James Smithson's will to the latest tweets from the museums. In addition, we have over 40,000 digitized images available on our website and a growing amount of digitized field books, correspondence, and other materials. Like the museums, we have an active exhibition program, and ours is, it's smaller, but it's focused on books and literature and the written word. We have two exhibition spaces, one in the National Museum of American History, seen here in this slide, and another smaller space in the National Museum of Natural History. To complement these exhibitions and other programs, we host free events through the year, including online lectures. And actually, we have two events coming up in the next month, a monthly film fest series. Our second event in that series is September 30th. And we'll have a talk by the curators of our exhibition, Magnificent Obsessions, Why We Collect, which again is pictured on the right there, on October 5th. And those are both free and online, and will also be recorded, and we welcome you to join us. As I mentioned, during more precedented times, we do welcome visitors to all of our 21 branches. Though we don't have a robust field trip program, we do offer educational tours, and we've welcomed some school groups even into our rare book rooms. And I do want to invite you also to connect with us using our monthly in our monthly newsletter. This is a great way to stay up to date with all of our happenings, events, and exhibitions, et cetera. We also have some very active social media profiles, and I'd welcome you to join us and keep up with what's going on there. You can stay up to date again with our events and exhibitions, but also explore some interesting collection items, learn more about Smithsonian history, and you'll find links to those at the bottom of all of our web pages, as well as in your handout. But since our branches are closed, I'm going to spend a lot of time today talking to you about how you can access our materials online. And the very first thing I want to introduce you to is the Smithsonian Collections Search Center. This searches across Smithsonian collections, including both digitized material and records for things that we haven't yet digitized. It's the best place to search across archives, libraries, and museums at the Smithsonian, besides the curated collections that you'll find in Learning Lab. So you'll find records there for both our library books as well as our archival records. So I'm going to click over and give you a very brief tour. So keep in mind that this is still a work in progress for the institution. As you can imagine, it's hard to document and take pictures of the 154 million items that we have at the Smithsonian. But luckily, most of our library books and the Smithsonian Institution archives materials are accounted for in this system. So say that you're teaching about the events that led up to the Civil War, and you want to discuss Uncle Tom's Cabin with your class. You're probably familiar with this title. It is a famous anti-slavery novel by Harriet Beecher Stowe. As soon as you go to type in a search field in the collection center, it'll start suggesting some common names for you. So I'm going to go ahead and type in Uncle Tom's Cabin and click on the suggested name. And you'll see that there are over 200 items in the Smithsonian collections that represent Uncle Tom's Cabin from all across the institution. But since I work at the libraries and I'm here to tell you specifically about library materials, I'm going to limit this to library stuff. And you can do that over here on the left. There are all kinds of ways to filter this content, but I'm going to click on Smithsonian Libraries to just show you what we have there. And even within our own collections, we have a couple of different resources that could be useful to you in teaching or learning about this subject. The first is actually a YouTube video that is a presentation from our National Museum of African American History and Culture librarian. The second is a blog post from our own blog about Uncle Tom's Cabin and exploring some of the early and notable editions of that title. And then as you look down, you'll see some more traditional library resources that you expect to find in a library. Microfilm, if you remember way back in the day, we still have some of that, as well as, of course, lots and lots of books. And one thing that you'll notice for our books is that you will often see a little thumbnail image. That means that we've actually digitized that book in its entirety, and it's available for you to read, download, use, reuse. And you'll also see the CC0 icon underneath. And that means that the material is public domain, it's open access. Not only can you use it in your classroom, but you can download it and put it on a coffee mug if you want. So I'm gonna go ahead and click on one of these thumbnails so you can see how to access the material. And then you'll view scanned book. And this leads you to our website, library.si.edu, to the digitized version of this 1852 edition of Uncle Tom's Cabin. And you can flip through the book right here on our webpage, but you can also download it. There are several download options, including Kindle. Or, you know, perhaps you just want to use the title page as a resource in your teaching, and you can just save image as and download it directly from our webpage. So going back to Collection Search Center, if we don't have a thumbnail or a CC0 icon there, it usually means that we haven't digitized the material, and that's often because of copyright or other restrictions. So this means that we might have the physical item in our collection, but we just can't provide access immediately across the country. And again, in normal circumstances, you could actually plan a research visit or sometimes request material through interlibrary loan. So Collection Search Center is a great first stop for finding some raw primary source material in the Smithsonian. And another way to access library-specific resources is through our own webpage, library.si.edu. As you saw, the Collection Search Center actually points over to this. And there is a ton that you could look through on our webpage, but I'm going to just point out these first three tabs. Online books is another way to access our digitized books directly. As you saw, Collection Search Center actually points you there. Digital Collections has some other great materials there that are worth exploring, including image collections and search pages for those trade literature and art and artist files that I mentioned earlier, so those sort of non-book collections. And then Exhibitions has information about both current and past exhibitions, and our exhibitions often have full web pages to go along with them. So if you can't make it to DC, you can take a peek at what our curators have put together for you. And another tool I want to show you is the Biodiversity Heritage Library. The Biodiversity Heritage Library, or BHL, is a consortium program based here at the Smithsonian, but it involves dozens of natural history libraries from around the world. And they've joined together to make their digitized material available all in one place. So researchers who are looking for material on a specific species can actually search hundreds of years of printed literature in one search. It's also an open access resource. So generally you're free to use and reuse, download, et cetera, in the classroom and beyond. So again, very quick little tour for you. You can use the search box right on the main page to type in specific book titles, like if you'd like to find a copy of Darwin's On the Origin of the Species, but you can also search by an animal's scientific name. So if your classroom is exploring narwhal, for instance, you can pop over to the advanced search, click on scientific names, and you can type in Monodon monoceros, and you'll find tons and tons and tons of digitized books about narwhals going back hundreds of years. But that can be a lot to dig through, and sometimes you just want a pretty picture, and luckily BHL does that really well as well. So I'm going to pop back over to their homepage and highlight their Flickr stream. You can, when we digitize books, we scan them cover to cover and everything in between. And that can make it really hard to pull out those pretty pictures from dense scientific texts. But luckily, BHL has done a lot of that through Flickr for you. And you're probably familiar with Flickr, so I don't have to tell you that it's an image sharing platform. But in particular, as I mentioned, BHL pulls out the pretty pictures from the books. As you can see here, they're organized specifically by title in their albums, but if you click on photo stream and the little magnifying glass, you can again type in narwhal or Monodon monoceros and find all of the pretty pictures related to those, to whatever animal that you're searching for. And again, a quick reminder that this is well more than Smithsonian material. This is dozens of libraries from around the country. So you'll find not just some of our stuff, but stuff from around the world, all in this open access resource. And BHL also has some really great help pages and FAQ pages with tutorials to help you figure out how to navigate the platform if you're interested in learning more. And now I'm going to close this and pass it over to Sara.
Thanks, Erin. All right, guys, let me share my screen here. One second. Okay. Of course. Come on, slideshow, you can do it. There we go. All right, sorry about that transition. So hopefully, well, here it is, it started again. This is not what I wanted. Give me one second, let me get to right where we want to be, which is starting with the educational resources. So again, I am the head of education for the Libraries and Archives, and it's my job to sort of take all these great things that we have in our collection and figure out a way to get them into the classroom, into the educators' hands, into the students' hands in a way that can be more meaningful. So one of the first things that we have is a sort of one-stop shop for educators on our website, and I'm going to go ahead and take you there right now. So this page, once it finishes pulling up, is our educators page with all of our resources that we've put together. As you may see, here it says the Smithsonian Libraries and Archives are just coming together. So that might pop up when you go to our website, as Erin mentioned, that we're still in the middle of joining forces. So here we have the classroom resources that we've actively created, and I'll go over these a little bit more in depth one-on-one. These are the digital collections. This is the sort of thing that Erin was sharing with you about, ways to look up what our books are. This is a great blog that Erin actually puts together, Unbound. So here's a really wonderful one-stop shopping for everything that we've already been pushing out. And then also some shout outs to things that are going on across the Smithsonian that are wonderful tools and resources as well. And I'll go over Learning Lab if you don't already know what it is a little bit more. And then again, in simpler times, you are of course able to come into the libraries and archives. Right now, that is obviously not happening. So let's go back to the screen here. So we've got our four educators resource. And another thing that we offer is a newer program called Traveling Trunks. Now, I should start this explanation with saying that these trunks are, of course, not traveling right now, which is a bummer, but we look forward to a safer world where we can actually share these high touch objects with people. So let me tell you a little bit about what you're looking at. We right now have two different kits. This one features Women in America, Extra and Ordinary. And then we also have one on Latinx narratives. And I'll show you a little bit more about that. But these are interactive kits that come with these cards and 3D printed objects, and they all sort of create these interactions that you can bring into your classroom or your museum or your homeschool classroom, you know, wherever that is. Also, we've got a landing page for it here on our website. But I think what might be most helpful for you to understand what these are is to see a little video that I've put together about our previous one. It's about 2 minutes long, so it kind of unpacks the traveling trunk for you and lets you see what we have and what you could borrow. It is when they're up and running, they are free, and we do ship it to anywhere in the US free of cost. So let me pull up the video and hopefully you'll be able to hear it and see it.
There is Traveling Trunks, Narrativas y Canciones edition. First off, your trunk comes in this box. Do not get rid of this box. You're gonna need to hold on to it so you can ship it back to us when you're done using the trunk. On the cover of the trunk, you're gonna see a map of Central America and the Caribbean. This tells you exactly what we're talking about in our content in the trunk. Inside the trunk, you've got four themed content boxes, four artifacts, a booklet, and a talking box. What you're gonna wanna do, first off, inside that booklet, is go through the checklist and make sure you got everything you're supposed to get. The four themed boxes are right here, and inside of the boxes, you're gonna have four visual cards and a record that plays music. Everything inside of the boxes plays on our talking box in both Spanish and English. Let me show you what that looks like. For example, here are two of our images from the Smithsonian Library's collection. Everything's gonna play on the box. First Spanish is gonna be slightly left of center. And then English is just slightly right of center.
Today, Puerto Ricans compose 10%.
So all of our image cards can do that. In addition, you're gonna get a record that plays four songs from the Smithsonian Folkways collection. You just place it on the box and rotate it. Each collection also comes with an artifact. Those are gonna play first in Spanish, then in English. The nice thing about this collection is you can kind of scale up or scale down depending on the age group you're working with. If you're working with younger kids, you want to just do an image search first off, great. And then you turn the images around and they turn into a map of the area that we're talking about. If you're looking to scale up for an older age group, you've got that 60-page booklet where it's got tons of information for a deeper dive into the content of each box theme. Also, you have open-ended questions, vocab, more information about the music, and finally, some questions about how to do good research. if you want to find any of this, any of the audio information, it's all on our website. You can find it at library.si.edu/traveling-trunks. Thanks.
Okay, so that's a little bit about the trunks. I did see that there was a question about if they are going to be able to travel again this year. Lord, I don't know is my only answer. I wish I did know more. Once I do know when these are up and running, if you'd like to share your contact with me, I'd be happy to be in touch with you all about that. We would really love to be able to continue to share these on a larger scale. I will say that if anybody's in the DC area, the one of the images that you're looking at right now, the Women in America, there will be, I think 8 out of the 24 women will be highlighted in the upcoming Futures exhibit that is going to open in the Arts and Industries building in mid-November. So if anybody is around and would like to check it out in person, you can go and explore it there. And then hopefully we will be able to start shipping them out maybe later this school year, but not this calendar year. So one of the things I wanted to share with you guys more specifically are the content and collections on Learning Lab. And we do have a poll question about if you've ever used Learning Lab before. So if you see that pop up, would love to see your answers. I am gonna open up this landing page of Learning Lab's collections that have been made just by libraries and archives. And if you're not familiar with what Learning Lab is, it's sort of, I often describe it as the Pinterest of the Smithsonian, where it's got everything we've ever digitized right there. And you can go and explore it. You could go in and type in horse and you're gonna get paintings of horses and artifacts of horses, bones, teeth, all sort, any sort of thing that has to do with that, that's across the different Smithsonian collections. So you then as a user could build your own collections in that way, or you can look at other already created collections and use that content in your classroom, assign it to your students to look at, whatever it is. So here we've got the Smithsonian Libraries and Archives landing page within Learning Lab. And these are 4 featured collections that I wanted to tell you all about. Let's do it in reverse order. So one of the first things that we've got going on here are some social and emotional learning collections. So with these, what we've done is I've taken images from our content across these, I think, are mostly from libraries. And then I've woven in these ideas of how to manage living through these big moments in history, which is what all of the students are doing right now. We've got this sort of dual pandemic, racial injustice, things going on that really need to be unpacked and given language to. So this is, for example, the first grade one where it's gonna weave in different social studies standards from a first grade curriculum, and then figure out how to talk through these sort of different ways and, you know, how we're experiencing these big feelings. So we've got a handful of these, and there will be more of these collections coming out in the spring. And then I can show you another set that we're working on called From This to That. So these are sort of connections across subjects and disciplines. We start as an anchor point with libraries and archives content, and then we pull in things from across all of the Smithsonian to sort of make a visual timeline and connection with things that are in the grades 9 through 12 social studies common core standards. That's sort of our starting point. So for example, I'll open up From Gold to Fur, and this will show you a little bit about the original colonization of the United States and the fur trading that went on, and then sort of the so what of it all, like what, how did that impact the indigenous populations, and how did that take their original desire for gold into this fur trade, and what did that do to the economy, and how did things come together from that? So this is just an example of one of the collections that we would have in this unit, where we've got World War I to suffrage, birds to buildings, volcanoes to bicycles, farm to city. There will be about 4 or 5 more of these being added within the next couple weeks, and just continuing to add a way to sort of connect these cross interdisciplinary, if you will, concepts within grades 9 through 12 Common Core. Now, you've seen a little bit already of this aspect of the traveling trunk. This is the Women in America Extraordinary Collection. As I've said, they're not traveling, so here is the digital access point for it right now. It's got 24 women. Let's open up one of them. In each of these collections, it's going to show you images from ours, but then also share out different aspects across the Smithsonian where these women might be highlighted. And each one, similar to the Latinx narratives video that I showed you, each one of these ladies highlighted has a song that sort of matched to her from the Smithsonian Folkways collection. So those are played on model cassette tapes on that interactive box, whereas the last one, they were played on model records. These are played on model cassette tapes, which is sort of a fun way to do it. And actually, I just added some content out of these external links just yesterday and today. This is the actress Anna May Wong in sort of that early Hollywood golden age, who was often marginalized and sidelined and typecast, being that she was a Chinese American. She was not given leading roles, and there were in fact laws that forbidden that. So this one is Gemma Chan, an actress recently at the Met Gala, sort of channeled the Anna May Wong's one of her famous looks, and they talk about her role in Hollywood, which I think is quite fascinating because these collections are sort of living, and we can continue to add to them as more stories come up about these women. So if we go back to the last collection, give me a second, for all of Learning Lab's amazing access, it is sometimes not the fastest. So here we are. This is our newest collection called Information Literacy. And keep your eyes out in the polls, because I know I've got a couple of questions about this. Really sort of one open-ended one, a little bit more generically, is just, you know, could you, as an educator, librarian, museum educator, whatever your sort of role is, use a resource on information literacy? That's one of the first things. We're just sort of interested to know if that's helpful to you guys. So we're just diving into this. My colleagues as librarians are, of course, expertly trained in how to use different various forms of media, how to conduct research, how to be aware of author bias, all sorts of things like that, and help users be successful in that as well. I myself am a museum educator and an art historian by trade, so I'm also sort of learning these things, and it's been a really good experience for me to work with my colleagues and try to put together these collections and figure out what do we have as a skill set that could be useful to the public. So what we started with, you can see here, those first three, I'll say Smithsonian. The font's a bit small, but we've got, we wanted to prove to the public that we are a trusted resource, and how did we get there? So we've got the Smithsonian as a trusted resource, the Smithsonian as a space for diffusing knowledge, and how do we do that with the public, and how do we share what we have here? So these are our sort of like starting points of who we are, who helped us be this trusted source, how do we involve the public in this process? And each one has these sort of final thoughts of how to wrap up what we're kind of trying to pitch to you and have you understand about us as a vetted resource. We also have a wonderful collection here based on a case study of a scientist at the National Museum of Natural History and asking her, okay, how have you used the libraries and archives in your research in a real like actual day-to-day basis? How do we help you? And what steps do you take to be successful as a scientist and as a researcher? So this is a really nice way to see that and how somebody has used our resources in a really professional and academic setting, obviously, but also gives examples of how anybody could be using them at a more K-12 level. Also, we, you know, thought, okay, if we are telling you that you can trust us, we should also be able to kind of evaluate outside sources and let you know how to figure out who else you can trust. So this is a vetted media resources collection that's going to be able to tell you how you can check what you're seeing and what's available to you and what sort of like how you can verify. And these are all sort of mostly media internet-based tips and tricks for you all. One of the good ways to check things is the crap test. If you don't know what that is, feel free to jump in here and look through it. And then you know, we recognize that, especially if you're in the classroom or in a school setting, you have to answer to these standards. And of course, we're going off of Common Core because we're trying to service the entire nation, but there are things that overlap quite a bit from local standards to the Common Core standards. And so we want to dive into those and start unpacking them and making collections that are specifically geared toward that. So I do believe we have another poll question, and I'll just go ahead and read out some of the things that we've pulled out of the standards that we see as things that could be extremely useful to unpack. But we'd love to hear from you all if there's any one direction that you'd like us to go, because this is a new endeavor for us and we've got room to sort of make those choices right now. You can see here that we've done one on primary sources. But we'd also got a list of, you know, author bias and point of view, fact versus opinion, summarizing, synthesizing, and analyzing text, citing textual evidence, paraphrasing versus plagiarizing, researching through various media and sources, and also assessing the credibility and accuracy of a text. So we'd love to continue to create these collections, possibly on those topics, or absolutely welcoming any other topics that you have that you'd like to hear from us on. If you want to drop that in the chat, by all means. I'm not sure if that last poll question went out. That's totally fine. If it didn't, just by all means, if you heard anything that was of interest to you, please put it in to the chat. Erin and I are both working on this project, as are a number of my colleagues. So we would just love to hear if anybody has any ideas or questions or would like to be even more involved in the information literacy process. We would be very happy to do so in a collaborative and community sense. Let me just stop here. Those are the major sort of resources that we've created at the educational level, and also all of the points of access that Erin shared with you that you can come to and do your own research. But if you guys have any questions in this moment, I'd love to just continue to see if anything flows in from the chat or if there's any results of the poll. Erin, if there's anything that came up in the chat that needs to be addressed, please let me know.
So we did have a great question about from Sherry, are you guys doing field trips or just personal visits? So if you want to just mention what kind of field trip-like options we have when we are open.
Sure, I can speak to days of yore in this moment, and I'm not 100% sure where we're going to be in the future, but something that we have been doing for a local audience was a program called Bookcases. And that was meant for a middle school audience on those sort of day offs, that like that parent-teacher conference day, that sort of like one, you know, floating day. So we tried to schedule programming on those days, and it's a day long interactive kind of escape room style mystery solving that the students do. And they go through our resources and they solve a mystery about, you know, sort of what went wrong the night of Reagan's inaugural ball at American History, of course these are fictitious, or we have one that's sort of set in the wizarding world. So they're very fun, and they bring you through the archives and libraries materials. You get your hands on them, you get to go into the libraries, you get to solve a mystery. So that's one of our things that we do in the education field. We also do host some smaller visits in the sort of field trip realm. Often it's for maybe a little bit of an older audience, but I think that there's always room for that conversation. And we're happy to have anybody that wants to come into our spaces when those are open again. I'll go ahead and put up Erin and I's contact. I think the last poll question is just sort of the cheeky question of who are you going to reach out to let you know that you're interested in information literacy, Erin or myself. But just overall, the point is that we'd love to hear from anybody that's interested, and we'd love to talk more and get feedback on the information literacy or honestly anything. And if you've got any other questions, please don't hesitate to contact us.
So we do have another comment, Sarah, from Kimberly, that the hot topic now is news accuracy. Could really use resources that help students evaluate accuracy.
Absolutely. Accuracy is one of the aspects that we'd like to pinpoint. So I'm glad to hear that. And that will be absolutely added to the top of the list for our next collection. Thank you.
And Crystal says, fantastic resources for homeschoolers. Book would be great for a monthly mystery for homeschool groups as well.
That's a wonderful idea. Yeah, I love that. Okay, friends. Well, if there is nothing else from you all, I'll leave it open for a minute in case there's any other last minute polls or chat questions to come through. And maybe I will stop this skeleton from waving at us all, because he does tend to go on, as delightful as he is. It's been a pleasure. Erin, anything else from your end?
No, thank you so much, everyone, for joining us. Oh, actually, there's some, because of the delay, there's now a couple of comments rolling in, of course.
Let's do it.
I do, before we get to the last couple of comments, I do want to mention on the previous slide that Sarah just had up with the obnoxious waving skeleton, there is an email address there for askalibrarian@si.edu. If you don't remember me, if you don't remember Sarah, that's a great line into the libraries and archives resources. Whether you want to bring a field trip group in, whether you want to suggest a learning lab collection, whether you want to figure out, you know, I'm trying to research this particular species and I'm coming up blank, I don't know where to go, or this person or this event. That's a great first step in reaching anybody from the libraries. But I think you've probably taken a look at all of these great...
I do see a great question from Wendy. Sorry to jump in. Wendy asked, what's the youngest age that would benefit from the traveling trunk? So we do try to make the trunks pretty wide open, as you may have seen in the video, the sort of like K to 12, even pre-K to 12. The audio and, you know, the written is done at about a middle school language level, but there are a lot of different aspects to it if you're just looking to do like a picture walk and listen to the music, so there, or do the puzzle aspect of it. So there's, it's made to be really scaled up or scaled down. I don't think that there's any wrong age with it, as long as somebody is sort of like interested in the tactile and the audio. I think that you can interact with it on a lot of different scales, which is sort of the goal of it.
Sorry. And there's a question from Karen about our traveling trunks available online.
Well, like I shared, the digital version of like the Women in America collection on Learning Lab, that's pretty much the online version of it in this moment. And we don't really have the availability to share all of that content except for in the trunk itself. This goes along with, there was a question about if we offer PD or workshops for educators. I'm a very small team. Right now I'm a team of one. So there are just not things, there are things I just can't do sometimes, unfortunately, as much as I would love to be able to pivot to a little bit wider scale and audience. But so right now, just some Learning Lab collections for the traveling trunks. And hopefully when we get the go ahead, we'll get those trunks back out.
I think we're about to wrap up, but one comment from Shelley about how to spot fakes in photos would be a great Learning Lab topic. Sherry asked, quick question. I know that you mentioned resources to download. Are there any audio resources? And I know that Sarah can talk more about how she's incorporated audio into Learning Lab and traveling trunks. The libraries itself doesn't have great audio collections as opposed to our colleagues in Folklife, et cetera. So we have not digitized a lot of libraries and archives related audio, but Sarah, would you like to take that for a turn?
Yeah, it's mostly Folklife is the answer there, as well as you saw that we incorporate a song for each object with the traveling trunk, and those can be found in those Learning Lab collections as a website that leads you to Folklife, so you can go and see where the song is from. But that is a nice thought to incorporate that a little bit more in the forefront. As of right now, the answer is no, but I would like to continue thinking on that. So thank you for the idea.
Oh, I should mention our colleagues in the Smithsonian Institution Archives have digitized quite a bit of audio and video materials. So you can also find those in collections search. And as I mentioned, there's actually a film fest going on to celebrate the Smithsonian's 175th anniversary. So if you are specifically interested in old movies, old home movies from the Smithsonian, we are hosting a monthly series to celebrate those.
Well, guys, I can't thank you all enough for attending. This was a real treat to be able to share all of our stuff, especially our new concept, the InfoLit. And just, yeah, please don't be strangers, get in touch. And if there's anything that we can do for you or any specific questions, let us know.
Thank you all.
Oh, and please take the survey if you haven't taken it yet today. Take the survey for the overall program.